media scholar, an award-winning professor and blogger. In addition to many other achievements, she serves as editor-at-large for The Root and chairs the Department of Mass Media Arts at Clark Atlanta. Nsenga, you live in this world, sort of online. What's your perspective?
I don't know if you're ready. Fake news. So, one of the things I love that you talk about is this whole idea of ideology. Can you all hear me okay? And this is one of the things that we talk about in academia. So I do live in this world. I'm an academic. I'm also a writer, journalist, trained journalist. So I'm old school. I look a little older than I am, but y'all know. So I'm a trained journalist, like old school. But I'm new school in terms of technology and media. So the way that I teach my students is I train them old school. Like they know how to write, they know what the lead is, they know how to investigate, things like that, that matter. And I always tell them that the way to be successful in the new media space and the new online space and to not be creating fake news is if you take those old school values and old school skills and approaches to really data collection and news gathering and apply it in the media space. So when we talk about fake news, the reason that people are very much able, and this is what Richard was talking about, to call whatever they don't like fake news is because we aren't very transparent about the news gathering process. And you really shouldn't have to take a class in journalism or major in it to understand how the news gathering process works. So, this audience, I'm assuming, is a little different and does fit into that group that Richard talked about, and that is people that are informed, interested in the topic, and have some knowledge of what we're talking about, a little bit at least. We can assume that, we'll make that assumption. But I think it's a false assumption for us to assume that most people have some idea about how journalism works. I think we're also living in a very anti-intellectual age, and a lot of people, and these are broad generalizations, but this is what I'm finding in my research and in my reading, so I'm just talking to you, I'm having a conversation, all right? But I think in terms of anti-intellectualism, journalists were thought of as being for the state. They checked the other three branches of government. That was our charge, all right? And so now I think, especially with new media in society and the cultural shift in society and the ways in which we communicate, it's just become less and less obvious in terms of who is checking whom, right? So when we hear this data, which is very good, but when we hear this data, a lot of times we don't understand how data is gathered. We don't understand how to interpret it. So in a space, whether it's a classroom or not, when you start giving people facts, even in a journalism program, I was at Grady last year, that's at UGA, which is one of the top programs in the country. I came out of Northwestern, right? So I go back there periodically. But even in journalism programs, you see the eyes glaze over like, oh, here we go, this is that partisan stuff. And it's like, no, this is data. These are the facts. Yes, this information may not apply to you because you're not in that sample, but it doesn't mean it's not inaccurate. All right, so I think that a lot of fake news has to do with the ability to transmit fake news and for people to not understand it. They don't understand how news is gathered. They don't understand how data is collected. They don't understand the difference between editorial and reporting. And when I say they, I mean most people, including most journalism students, is what I'm finding. And so I spend a lot of my time, even in journalism programs, teaching students the difference between fake news and real news. Now, particularly when we talk about this last election, and there's just not enough time. But when we talk about this last election, students, there were some that are independent, there's some that are democratic, there's some that are anti-establishment, I have students that identify as anarchists, I have students that identify as democrats. So you have all these categories, but we only have two political parties right now, official political parties. But even in those spaces, and even though we were focusing on reporting on the election from a student perspective, there was still a lot of discussion about what information was important. So when we think about agenda setting, right? When we think about who gets to set that agenda, you know, Fox actually has an agenda, all right? And I think that, and I hate the term like conservative, you know, because as a black person in America, it's the same to us in a lot of ways. But some more liberal publications, more liberal media companies, they have an agenda. But others, I think, is gray. Right, it's a gray area. You're not sure if they have an agenda. We're not sure who's setting the agenda. We're not sure how we're getting this information, who's doing the reporting, who sent out, what are the resources, and all of these things that we think about intellectually when we're looking at these slides, when we turn on the television, and so forth and so on. So I think a lot of it is a fundamental lack of education, which is tied to a lack of transparency in how we talk about the news and how we talk about how news is gathered. So, another thing I want to talk about is ideology. Ideology is very important in the ways in which people process news. So it's not surprising that people don't want to hear the news. We are tasked with bringing people the facts, the truth. And we are tasked with removing ourselves as much as possible from the subject. Now, in some cases, it's very hard to do. Like, that's true, we're all human beings. We all have feelings, we all have thoughts, or what have you. But whether you are a researcher, like an academic, whether you are a journalist, in the same case with judges and lawyers, you are supposed to have and remove yourself from the situation, from the subject, in order to have some type of objectivity and to really report what the facts are. That's very difficult to do, particularly in a society that is deeply rooted in dominant ideologies. Ooh, can you? In dominant ideologies. Dominant ideologies, when I talk about dominant, I'm talking about the ruling class. So if we're talking about race in this country, we might be talking about wealthy whites. If we're talking about gender in this country, we might be talking about wealthy white men. If we're talking about class, you know, we might be talking about wealthy people. You know, it just depends on what the stratas are, all right? But dominant ideology suggests that the media can't be trusted. It is not new, all right? Richard talked about, I think you said broadsheets. Chat books, all of the beginning, right? And all of that was new technology at one point, all right? And it was very hard to get a handle on that. But a lot of us do not know the difference between propaganda. This is how Hitler came to power, you know? This is how we had the Protestant Reformation, right? People don't know the difference between propaganda, news, information, and so you have all of these things being bombarded because we add technology to it, technological development. And I want people to remember, at one point, all of this is new technology. The typewriter was a new technology once. The printing press was new. We think of that as old. So it's not really that different. It is in terms of speed, but not in terms of concept. So when you magnify that, then you can put a story out with 140 characters, which is fabulous. I love how people use Twitter to tell stories and what have you. It's interesting, except when it's not factual. And people are like, oh, I need to make a decision based on this non-factual information that's been creatively done. So, you know, we're moving in a society that is very fast. It is still tied to those dominant ideologies about race, class, gender, sexuality, sexual identity, all of those things. And so it's easy to me as a user of media and as a creator, because, you know, I think we have to own that too, right? Because we're always, you know, we're distant from the subject, but we actually create, we set the agenda, we decide what's going to be in the paper or online or what have you. Like, who are we going to take? Where's this going to be? What social platforms are we going to put it on? All right. So it's easy, I think, to see why people doubt media. That's not new. What is new, though, is the quickness with which traditional media and what I would call actually vetted media is dismissed. That's a problem. And that's how one of the reasons that contributes to this illness that we have. So we have many illnesses in the United States: racism, sexism, heterosexism, homophobia. You just go right on down the line. And so now we have media, which is another form of illness, like the anti-intellectualism, anti-media, right? So it's like, I don't want to hear your facts. It's like, oh, but they're facts. I'm not telling you how to interpret them, right? And then it's like, oh, let me interpret these facts, you know, because that's more easier to interpret the facts. Yeah, but they're still facts. So even if you remove the interpretation, what are the facts? Now, how do you want to deal with them is up to you. Whether you want to ignore them, whether you want to accept them, whether you want to act on them, whether you want to be passive, whether you want to, like, fire off something on Facebook and then have a cocktail, that's the type of thing. revolutionary. A lot of people are nowadays, they get pissed off, and they're on Facebook, and then they go have a cocktail, they go to happy hour. I mean, whatever you want to do, that is what's going to work for you. But dismissing people who are actually invested in and spend their livelihoods doing this research, doing this news gathering, is problematic. It's problematic. When you have folks who have spent, you know, I have a PhD, so let's say 12 years of graduate study, it was a lot, and it was expensive. But when you have people who have done that type of study, and people are just like, who cares what they say? He got, one election wrong in like 40. Ah, never gonna listen to him again. That's a problem. So there is an article, I'm gonna point you to some resources. And 2 days ago, September 17th, 18th, I think, in the New York Times, there was an article that came out that talked about fake news. And in it, they quoted Kathleen Hall Jamison, my former dean, who's the current director of the Annenberg Public Policy Center at UPenn. And she talked about three ways that we can actually think about how to combat or deal with, because, you know, some people are okay with fake news. I'm not really okay with fake news. I live in the real world, I deal with facts. So she talked about three ways that we can combat or challenge or deal with fake news. One of which was to stop spreading fake news. And that seems like a very minimal thing to do, but we spend a lot of time just regurgitating fake news. Go on Facebook, go on Twitter, go on Snapchat, any other social media, Instagram. You know, how many times do you have to say, and I, you know, based on Facebook statistics, I have a very educated phone, but I have to sometimes say, oh my gosh, that's not the onion. That's actually a real story. Or, oh my gosh, that's the onion. Do you know what that is? You know what I mean? Right? So I spent a lot of time educating people about telling the difference. And a lot of that has to do with what Pete is talking about and what Richard talked about is the media. We have so many skills and technology now, which is fantastic. I love it. But we can recreate whatever we want. We can recreate the scene. Like, we can walk out of here and within an hour recreate the scene and change all of the information that came out of it. When you have that type of ability and access, it's fantastic. But it's also challenging because some people are going to use that to the detriment of society. So I think when you have these things working hand in hand, it's a problem. But she talks about one, stop spreading the lies. Two, she also talks about being transparent, all right? Talking about the news process, telling people, like that's what we have done as journalists. And I think part of that is because we have sources. We try to have discretion. We try to protect people. We try to protect our colleagues. Right? And so that's part of the culture. But in having that and being in this magnified society now, we have to do differently. Because if we don't change the ways in which we share information and even the news gathering process, then I think it will continue with this whole idea of, oh, you know, you can have President Trump say, oh, CNN is fake news. Okay. And then lastly, she talks about the use of video, which I love. Video, people in this generation, and it is true. And even video is good for SEO, that's just a point out there. But video, and that's search engine optimization, but video is good because people, many people now, don't really want to read our fabulous writing. They don't care that we know the 8 parts of speech. They don't care that we write the subject verb agreement. They don't care that we do Pulitzer Prize winning and that we struggle and think about stories and spend years of our lives covering them and chasing them down and going overseas. They don't care. You know, it's not all people, of course, but many people don't care. But if they can see it, and this is in some cases, not in cases of police brutality necessarily, right. But in other cases, if they can see it, they will believe it. And so she says that one of the ways that we can combat this whole fake news is to actually debunk it in a visual medium, because that's how most people are engaged, or many people in, you know, a younger demographic, younger than me, are engaged in the news. And so that's one way to connect with those folks. And this is what I'll leave you with, this idea of connection. That's very foreign to media people in terms of journalists. Our goal is to stay away from you so that we can be objective, get the facts, report. All right, and there's all types of journalism. You know, long form is different. But for the most part, when we're talking about reporting, we You just want facts, and so I have to remove myself. We have to now connect with people. That is why people are watching Fox. They have an agenda, and they have connected with people who share the same dominant and perverted ideologies that they do. And they're very clear on it. This is who we are, this is what we do. If you are like us, watch us. Do this, vote this way, do this thing. So I'm not saying it's a good thing or a bad thing, it is what it is. That's why people watch MSNBC, and I hate to equate the two, but MSNBC, because I'm hearing what reflects my way of thinking. Right, so they're connecting with people in ways, and that's largely through editorial, and not so much through reporting, but I think that we have to really be mindful of how do we connect with people. People are disconnected in a very connected world. That's the great irony. And that's a great challenge, though. I don't think it's a negative necessarily. I think it's a challenge. How do we connect with people and gain or regain their trust in this ever increasing problematic society that really is just having a problem dealing with facts and truth as it relates to lots of different industries and different populations, and news is just not able to that. That's it.
It's okay to call something a lie when it's a lie. If something is an outright, a bold-faced lie, it's okay to call it an outright, bold-faced lie. It'll be okay to